Hello, my dear students, welcome to the video. And since we are studying romantic writers, so it is extremely important for us to study Samuel Taylor Coleridge. We have heard his name when we were talking about William Wordsworth, and when we got to know that Wordsworth collaborated with Coleridge when they worked on this little epoch-making book called The Lyrical Ballads. But apart from being a poet, Coleridge was a critic and a great philosopher also, and he is credited with having introduced German thinking, German philosophers Immanuel Kant and Schelling to the English audience. Before Coleridge, not many people in England, they knew about German scholarship, German critical thinking, but he was the one who introduced that thinking into England, and he was influenced by their philosophy, and he incorporated that philosophy to create a very unique poetic philosophy of his own. He laid excessive emphasis on imagination, and his poetic theory is also based on imagination, and he has explained in his various books but how imagination is an extremely important aspect of poetry and how that imagination takes you closer to the truth. And finding the truth is what artists do, what poets do, what writers do. So imagination is an important component of that process of finding the truth. So this is one of his major contributions. As a poet, he is also very unique. He had a very different poetic philosophy, different poetic style than his contemporaries. And in this video, I am going to talk about his personal circumstances and how he was shaped, his poetic genius was shaped by his circumstances, and how he he used all his experiences to become the poet that he was. So starting from his early life, it is important to note that he was born in the year 1772 in Devonshire in England, and he died in 1834 also in London. And his father was Reverend John Coleridge, and he was the headmaster of the King's College, which was a local grammar school. And it is also important to note here that Coleridge was extremely influenced by his father. His father's reading ability, reading capability, reading habit he inherited, and he was very much influenced by his father's taste. And his mother was Annie Bowden, who was the second wife of Reverend John Coleridge. And Coleridge was the youngest of his siblings. And when he was very young, he was an extremely prodigious reader. He, instead of going out and playing with other children, he would prefer to stay indoors, and he would read a lot. And his reading would include as exotic and romantic writings as the Arabian Nights entertainments. And right from the beginning, he was fascinated by all these romances and imaginative writings. And in 1781, his father died when he was very young, 8 years old, and he was sent to this school in London, which is called the Christ Hospital, and he remained there for the most part of his, he completed his schooling from that school. And then in 1791, he entered Jesus College in Cambridge. Now, this life that he had at Cambridge, it is extremely important in shaping his ideas and in deciding the course of his life. So he was an extremely voracious reader, and particularly in works of imagination and visionary philosophy. As I told you, even when he was a small child, he would read those writings. He was more interested in those writings which would have more emphasis on imagination, which would have more imaginative input in them. And he would when he reached college, and he was a grown-up boy now, so he got interested in philosophy also. And also we have to remember that this was a time I mean, around this time, the French Revolution took place, and the whole world, not just Coleridge, but the whole world was influenced by this revolution. So while he was in college, Coleridge, he was also influenced by the ideas of French Revolution, and like many other people, he was also disappointed when these ideals were not materialized, and when that whole revolution, it lost its path and it went somewhere else. So while he was at Cambridge, he was remembered for his eloquence and prodigious memory. But at the same time, in the third year of his college, since he did not have any father and he was being supported by his relatives, so he had financial difficulties, and he left London, he left the university, and he enlisted himself as a soldier under the assumed name of Silas Tomkin Cumberbatch. But his friends and his relatives, they brought him back to Cambridge. Now, when he was brought back to Cambridge, this period is going to be an extremely important period in his life. And during this period, he came into contact with Robert Southey. Robert Southey is an extremely important name when we are studying Romantic Age. And he was friends with Robert Southey. He was friends with Charles Lamb also. And with Robert Southey, he planned a pantisocracy in collaboration with Southey. So, as I was talking about the French Revolution, he was not satisfied with the way the revolution was taking shape and the direction in which it was going. And he always imagined a world which would be ideal, a world where all the people would have equal say in governance, equal say in policy making. So he and Southey, they thought of starting a separate community, and they thought of starting this community in Pennsylvania and establishing pantisocracy. So pantisocracy is that type of government where all the people, whether rich or poor, they have equal say in governance. So they thought that they would start a different community, and all the children in that community, right from their childhood, right from the beginning, they will be given a particular kind of training, and they will be, then they, the whole society would, it would be a particular kind of society. I mean, it would be an ideal society where people would be shaped, their thinking would be shaped in a way that they would respect diversity, they would respect freedom of others, and it would be an ideal world to live in. And they planned to set up this community in Pennsylvania, as I've already told you. And for this ideal, he left Cambridge without a degree. This, we have to remember that he could not complete his education at Cambridge. And because he wanted to establish this pantisocratic society, so he left Cambridge and he married. Now, why did he marry in such a hurry? Because they wanted to establish the society, and Robert Southey and Coleridge, they decided, they were these two sisters, so they decided that both of them will marry one of the sisters. I mean, Robert Southey married one of the sisters, and Coleridge married this lady called Sarah Fricker in October 1795. Now, 1795 is that time, around this time, he also befriended Wordsworth. But this marriage was a complete failure, and it was very difficult for Coleridge he did not have any happy married life. So the worst blow of his life came to him when Southey defected from the pantisocratic scheme. That is, Robert Southey, despite having Coleridge married to Sarah Fricker, he gave up this whole plan of establishing this community and having a pantisocratic society. This was the worst blow that Coleridge could receive. Now, at the same time, at this moment, I would also like to mention that Coleridge had, his physical constitution was weak, and he had some ailments. So he was given opium for treatment, but gradually he became addicted to opium. So we have to remember that having an unhappy household life and then physical health failing and opium addiction, they all made a mess of his life. He was not really happy in his personal life. Now, around this time, as I have already told you, that he became friends with Wordsworth, and they started working on lyrical ballads, as we know. And around this time also, he wrote some of the greatest poems that we remember him for. He wrote The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, he wrote Kubla Khan and Christabel. So these are the kinds of poem that we remember Coleridge for, and particularly The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. So he was composing poetry, but at the same time, he was fighting many battles on the personal field. Now begin the troubled years of his life. So in 1798, he was having a rough patch in his life, his married life was not happy, but 1798 he received this annuity of £150, and this gave him some freedom. So he went to Germany with William Wordsworth and Dorothy Wordsworth. Now this trip to Germany was very important to him, because he attended many lectures there, and he got himself acquainted with German scholarship. As I told you in the beginning, he is that philosopher, that thinker that introduced German critical thinking to the English audience, to the English scholars. So this trip to Germany was extremely important. And one important point is that around his 30th year, Coleridge gave up this particular profession of a poet. I mean, he became a critic and he delivered lectures, but poetry took a back seat. So this trip to Germany, it gave him that scholarship, it gave him those necessary skills which would help him later on in his life to enter into this field of literary criticism. And when he went to Germany he became aware of German scholarship. And then during this time, around this time, I mean during the towards the end of 18th century, we all know that William Wordsworth's wife was Mary Hutchinson. Now Sarah Hutchinson was her sister, Mary Hutchinson's sister, and Coleridge fell in love with Sarah Hutchinson since he was not having a very good married life. So he fell in love with Sarah Hutchinson. And around this time also, why do we call these years troubled years? Because around this time his dependence on opium increased, and he thought that maybe he could improve his health by going to warmer climates. So in 1804 he accepted a post in Malta as secretary to the governor. So he went to Malta. He thought that maybe being away from England would help him, being away from Sarah Hutchinson would help him regain his physical as well as mental stability. But he returned to England, and then he separated from his wife. So these years, they are troubled years. And during this period also, he wrote that famous ode, Dejection and Ode, because he was facing this rough patch in his life. And that ode he composed, and he wrote that ode as a letter to Sarah Hutchinson to express his dejection, to express his disappointment with the way the things were at that time. So, but later on, during the beginning of 19th century, he parted ways with the Wordsworth. This was a serious blow to his stability, because he was emotionally attached to them, but he realized that he could not go on any longer like this. He was expecting to have a platonic relationship with Sarah Hutchinson, but that did not work out. So he parted ways with the Wordsworths, and after some time he started regaining reviving his critical instincts. And around this time, as I already told you, that he was a very famous critic also. So around this time he started lecturing on William Shakespeare. He was always fascinated by Shakespeare and his scholarship and the psychological analysis of his characters. So he started his famous series of lectures on William Shakespeare. And around this time also, in 1813, his play Remorse was staged. Now, later years of his life, towards the later years of his life, he read this book, Robert Layton's commentary on the first letter of Peter. Now, why it is important for us to know all this is because this particular book that we are talking about, Robert Layton's commentary, it gave him a different kind of solace that he was searching for. He was troubled, as we know that his personal life was disturbed. He was troubled and his health also did not support him. He had this very serious opium addiction. So this commentary, it helped him find a perspective and find a balance that he was looking for. And at the same time, during the later years of his life, that is after 1813s, he started writing larger works. I mean, earlier he stopped writing larger works. He was only writing shorter poems. He was lecturing. He was busy as a critic. But around this time, he started this very important work called Biographia Literaria. This work is important because it is said to be one of the first works in formal literary criticism in English language. So he started working on this important book, and then there was this new dramatic piece, Zapolye. It came out, I mean, it was a drama that he wrote, and he became a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature in 1824. So these later years, though he was addicted to opium, but still, so far as his creativity is concerned, so far as creative output is concerned, they were productive years. And as far as his major works are concerned, the first major work is Lyrical Ballads. We all know that, and we all know why it is so important, because it started the Romantic Revolution. It started the Romantic Age, so to say. Then this small piece called Frost at Midnight, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, I've already talked about it, Kubla Khan, Christabel, France and Ode. He wrote this during the earlier period, I mean, the last decade of the 19th century. Dejection and Ode, he wrote it in the beginning of 19th century when he was having a rough patch in his domestic life. And then the most important work of all, Biographia Literaria, which is considered to be the beginning of formal literary criticism in English language. So these are some major works by Coleridge, and Coleridge's contribution and his impact on English speaking, I mean on English writers and posterity, has been immense. He and Wordsworth collaborated on Lyrical Ballads, but he is an extremely different kind of a poet, and his poetic philosophy was completely different to what Wordsworth's was. He laid extreme emphasis on imagination, and he talked about it, and he exemplified that role of imagination in all his works. So this is all for this video. And I'll see you in the next video with an analysis of his poem, Christabel. Thank you.